Hi, this episode covers the events in 1976 calendar year. This year is a year of very huge transition in my life and career. For one thing, I completed successfully my pre-PhD examination, which is a combination of written examination plus an oral examination. If anybody, any candidate flunks in any one of the papers, then he will have to repeat it, or the faculty will decide, or the concerned professor will decide whether this could be, the knowledge in that flunked paper could be covered in the at the time of oral examination. So another thing that happened in that year, especially in the spring semester of 1976, is my huge effort and my effort in drafting all the supporting figures and diagrams for the PhD thesis, and as well as making the PhD thesis in the written form. And of course, I had a very wonderful guide, Dr. Hand. Dr. Hand is an exemplary person in that he will not ask his students, in the manuscript or the draft submitted, rewrite, delete, change. These things he will never do it. He does it for the student on his own. This is actually a great relief compared to other teachers in the department who just put exclamation marks on the margin of the manuscript, and they will say delete, or they say rewrite. And those students who go through this kind of comments, they curse themselves most of the time, because whatever you produce in the manuscript of your PhD thesis, in every page, is your ultimate effort. And the supervisor is asking you to change that. And on that, most of the students will sleep through, worry through, and in the mind curse the supervising teacher as to what he exactly meant. So that way, Hand was a far superior man, a mindset that is always helpful to the students. And this is exactly what Charlie Bartberger or Brian Trask had informed me about the attitude of Bryson. So Bryson used to have his office in the same floor where I was sitting, and every evening on his way down to his car, through the stairs in the east edge of the building and in front of my office, he'll stop for a second and ask me, "Vic, do you have something for me?" I will say, "No, sir." Or I will say, "Yes, sir, here it is." Whether it is one chapter, part of the chapter, or 5 pages, or one segment or section of the thesis manuscript I made, he will gladly take it. And the following morning, he comes up by the same route, and I will be there in my office before 7:30, because I have to work hard to do the entire work of drafting, etc. I did not engage anybody to draft, and he will, Dr. Hand will hand over whatever he has corrected and read through. It was a great relief. I had to draft all the figures for this thesis myself, because that was cheap. In other words, there are students in the Department of Geography who will charge $10 or upward of $10 for an A4 sized diagram they create. If it is an A3 or A2 sized map, Then, of course, you know, the price is negotiable, can go up to $50 or $75. You know, for those students doing cartography or have done cartography, this is a very important source of income during their college days. So, however, I chose to do the drafting on my own. So, I had to go out and buy the, you know, drafting materials. Paper, of course, is there. It is a gateway only. And then the tools I had to buy. I had to buy the template, I had to buy the pen holder, and I had to buy a whole set of Kohinoor drafting pens. And this is not a very simple thing. The whole price of all the three items went beyond $100, but it is worth. For one thing, I learned how to do it. For secondly, if I were to go for the transfix, in other words, you know, you can let, when it comes to lettering, those days you will have to buy a transparent sheet, a wax paper on which the letters of different font sizes are printed, alphabets are printed, and you will have to, you know, transfer those alphabets over to the drafted thing. Then, you know, as most people know, the letter S is the first thing you exhaust. Then not for one S or five S's, you'll have to go up, down to the bookstore and buy another sheet. Those sheets are like $1.50. So finally, most of the students end up with so many sheets of such a transfer lettering type, that finally everything goes into the dumpster, and also, you know, so much money also follows that way. So that was about the drafting. And you know, every day or most of the weekdays, I meet Dr. Hand in his office, and he was quite happy about how I was progressing, and he was also happy about the results I came up with. And then Dr. Han suggested, Vic, you choose a time somewhere along in the month of October or in the fall semester 1976 to defend my PhD thesis. So that means a lot. In other words, before that, I will have to get the entire thesis with all the supporting figures and tables, etc., approved first by the supervising teacher, that is Dr. Han. And then what I have to do is, once that is done, you know, he will have definitely some kind of penciling in this report, in the manuscript, the monograph. Then I have to fix all those. I will use my own typewriter to do that. And then I will have to make copies of it. And I'm making copy, you know, Xerox copy only. And then these, I have to make at least 5 copies, because, you know, 5 different examiners will have to read it. My examiners were outside of hand: Dr. Merriam, Dr. Muller, Dr. Brower, Dr. Dean, and Mr. Professor Robert Black from the College of Forestry and Environmental Sciences in the State University of New York at Syracuse, adjacent to Syracuse campus. You know, something very special about the adjacent campus, there is no compound wall separating the Syracuse University property and the State University of New York Environmental Sciences and Forestry College property. That is the interesting thing. If it were in India, there would have been very tall 10-foot walls, and on the top of it there would be Y-shaped clamps and then what you call a wire mesh. All those will be put there. A huge fence will be erected. Well, you know, we are actually enjoying building fences in between our own people and our own institutions for some unknown reason. Okay, then coming back to my first draft, final draft that is ready for reading by process. Well, Muller was the first person to return the manuscript. Muller had scribbled in so many things on the margin and on the blank side of the one side typed paper. And I was flabbergasted by the comments by Muller. And then I took this manuscript over to Bryce Hand and spoke to Bryce and said, oh, this is what really Mandler has done. And then Hand advised me to go back to Mandler and verify with Mandler what I have to do with these comments. Then I wanted to see Mandler. Mandler said, Vic, let us sit down at 4 o'clock this evening. Well, yes, sir, I said. And then by 4 o'clock, I was in his office. The first thing he did was he offered me an apple. He's, one of the things he does always in the office, he doesn't smoke. Whenever you walk into his office, he'll be munching an apple. So he came down from his office desk to the, there is a sofa set for the guests and the professor to sit. And I sat in the guest chair, and the professor Mandler asked me, saw the manuscript in my hand, and he asked me, what about this? I said, sir, you had made so many comments on the margin and also on the blank side of the paper. I don't know what to do with this. What was your intention in writing in all those comments? Then Mandler asked me, do you agree with those, the comments I had written? Well, sir, yes and no. Okay, then you know what Mandler told me? You have a Staedtler eraser, right? Yeah, take the eraser and erase all those penciled in comments, but keep them in your mind, okay, when you do a manuscript. Yeah, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it at all. I'm passing you. Your manuscript is passed for defense. Then, of course, James Brower, our paleontologist, also passed my manuscript. Then, naturally, Dr. Merriam followed suit, and Professor Dean had some comments. And again, I went back to Dean and, wanted his clarification about the comments he made. And Dr. Dean said, just like what Mandler said, if you agree with my comments, you correct it. If you don't disagree, if you don't agree with my comments, erase it. Because, you are the one who is in charge of what you did. And pretty well, what you did. And we are only reading it, okay, your report on your work. So then Robert Black, walked over to the department and returned the copy of the thesis he read to the office of the, Professor Merriam. And I finally got it in my letterbox. So the next thing was to, it is actually fall semester for September, and my job was to go to the, run between the graduate school, the Steel Hall, and my department office to get a date fixed for the defense. So Professor Merriam told me that if we get a date, for example, first week of October, let us do it then. Because now there is no point in waiting anymore. You've all done and you're all through. Except what remains is your defense of the thesis. So I reported back to the graduate school. Very interesting thing happened in the Steel Hall of the graduate school. And the person concerned, after a small talk, that lady asked me to give a handwritten name, my own name, in uppercase, we call uppercase letters, the way my name shall appear in the diploma or the PhD certificate the university will issue. In India, nothing of that sort will happen. Even if some error is made, you'll have to go pay a fee and get it corrected, and that is a Herculean task. Even a letter is added extra or dropped. So here, look at the difference. They are so cooperative and they are so careful that they want to get your view on the way your name shall appear in the PhD certificate. So I wrote that down, and of course immediately this lady typed it and then gave me a copy to verify, and then I said, well, fine. She said, that's it. Okay, wish you good luck. So on the October came, and first week on Wednesday afternoon at 2 o'clock in the legendary hall of the Hero Geology Lab, and I think that is 212 or so. It is a hall, 4 rows of seats, and a fairly large hall. It, the 4 rows means, you know, at least 40 students can be accommodated at any point in time. At 2 o'clock, the committee came together and took their seat in the podium on the desk, in the, you know, behind the desk. And then Chairman Dr. Miriam, you know, greeted all the students that are gathered, and especially me, the presenter, or the key player of that afternoon, and wanted me to make the presentation, you know, with the help of slides. I had made 35mm slides, and in consultation with the Dr. Hand and the approval of Dr. Hand, and made a presentation. Now, I was told not to exceed 30 minutes. I managed to contain it within 30 minutes, and then the chairman said, Professor Miriam said, told the entire audience, now this presentation of our results of the research is open for discussion, questions and comments. And he told the students, you can start off. You know, some of my friends asked questions, not very damaging or helpful questions rather, to make myself relaxed. And then there were no more other questions. Then Professor Miriam said, well, now it is our turn, the examiner's turn. Everyone went on with one questions or some supplementaries. So, you know, what had happened was, you know, 20 to 30 minutes just flew past. Then Professor Miriam said, well, we are excusing the student audience. Mick, not you, you had to stay back. And then the room was, door was closed, shut. Then, you know, every examiner took turns to again go on interrogating me, just to, I think later as a post facto thing, I think this they wanted to figure out how I cleverly and intelligently handle the questions, comments or observations as a scholarly person, yeah, because, you know, that is what probably the intention was. There was no point, at no point in time, there was any attempt to pick holes. Of course, Brouwer had some questions or some regarding the holes in the thesis. And then Brouwer said, Vic, don't worry about it. I just made an observation, that's all. But you did well, you did well. You know, he repeated that. So this went down for about half an hour. Then, of course, it was something like 3:30, and the committee said, Professor Miriam said, Vic, you are excused. Then I went out of the defense hall, and then what happened was, I waited, you know, impatiently outside of the hall, in the doorway, shut doorway, and after 8 or 10 minutes, you know, every minute looked like 1 hour. You know, when you are anxiously waiting for the results to be announced by the committee. You know, committee can make recommendations of granting the degree based on the manuscript, or they can make recommendations for amending parts of the thesis, or they have the, in the worst case, they have the authority to reject the thesis. Unfortunately, I had seen one man's PhD thesis was being rejected by the committee, but of course, by his own supervisor. But then, you know, Professor Miriam intervened and then told, no, the university, the Hero Geology Lab will not reject your thesis. Instead, he will be given an opportunity to do the revision and resubmit. So then, in a moment of time, Dr. Miriam opened the door and called me in, ushered me in, sort of. And then I was asked to take a seat. I sat down, but very tense. Then what happened was, Miriam, in the introductory remark, like Vic, we have deliberated on the quality of your thesis, your capabilities, your intelligence, your overall performance, etc. And finally decided to recommend the award of PhD degree of Syracuse University to you. And we accept your PhD thesis manuscript the way you have submitted for the defense. And then he called me Dr. Trivikramji, KP. Then I stood up, thanked each and everyone in the committee profusely. I was relieved, I was elated, I was exhilarated because I am now onwards, then point, that point onwards, then on, I am a PhD degree holder of the Syracuse University, upstate New York. That is how it all ended up.